Agenda item today is consideration of the Scottish Government's resource spending review, and we are now joined by Sarah Cameron, Development Manager, Social Enterprise Network Scotland. Can I welcome you, Ms. Cameron, to the meeting? And we will move straight to questions. And if I can take the liberty of asking the first question. In your written submission, you quote a statistic that 66% of GPs agree that engagement with the arts is good for the preventative health agenda. Many cultural organisations do not have their own internal budget to develop solutions for health and social care. And I wondered if you had any observations on how we can begin to square that particular circle.
Hi. First of all, can I thank you all for inviting me along today to speak? This is a really interesting question, and I think maybe one that social enterprises themselves have been playing with for many years, how exactly they deliver on this. I think there are a variety of different ways that the government could support the work around, the development of resources so that social enterprises can meet the needs of our population, really. I think we all agree the importance of culture, but there are various different approaches out there. I think social prescribing is something that you have spoken about previously, I believe, within your committee meetings, or something that has come up, and it's definitely a way to look forward, and it's certainly something that, if it is a real consideration of government, has to be addressed properly and has to be resourced in the appropriate way. There is an issue around the development of work. So there are lots of social enterprises out there doing pieces of work around culture, around health, that they are not necessarily being paid for. So they're developing their own systems. They are delivering because it is of the need of their community, as opposed to being paid for. And I think that there's something about developing a voice for the sector, so cultural and creative organisations can start to communicate better with the health sector, start to explore exactly what that means without putting more strain on the organisations themselves. That's a difficult approach, but maybe there's something to some links there with academia to explore exactly how those issues can be, explored in a different way to how it currently is. I'm not quite getting that right, but you know, there's systems in place. Our social enterprises, our cultural and creative organisations are going about it in a different way. So can we explore exactly what they're doing, what the benefits are of them doing that, and start to explore how we can resource those different ways of working, start to develop models that actually work and provide opportunities. I think that if you look at health and social care, I'm no expert in health and social care, but the private sector is in there and making it work for them. So why can't we resource the third sector? Why can't we resource our cultural and creative organisations in the same way, if that makes sense? I'm not sure I'm really answering your question so much as throwing up more questions. If that makes sense. I think that there's an awful lot of work to be done. There is work going on out there, but it's under the radar. I'm sorry, I don't think I've answered your question there.
You've been very helpful, and I think if anything, you've highlighted that there, you know, this is an issue. One of the things that you refer to in your submission is the Spring Project, and I just wondered if you could tell us a bit more about that. It sounds fascinating.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so again, I'm not at the heart of this this project, but I think that what is important here is the collaborative approach that has happened around the Spring Social Prescribing Project, a collaborative approach that has equality at the heart of it as well. I think is really, really important, and really developing those relationships on the ground and empowering community-led organisations to take a lead, I think has been a really important aspect of the work that they have been doing. I would note as well that they have been doing this for quite a long time. The Spring Project is not new. It has been something that has been going on for a few years now. And obviously, there. I think it would be, if this is something, social prescribing is something you're interested in, it would be definitely worth having a conversation with the folk involved with the Spring Project. And I'm sure that they would be interested in linking with government too. I mean, they're already linked with government in some aspects, but I think that they would be interested in linking beyond the health and social care directorate, actually linking into the cultural directorate and to other areas as well, which kind of goes back, I guess, to the point that I'd made about the importance of collaboration.
Thank you very much. Can I turn now to questions from colleagues and start with Jenny Minto?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Sarah, for coming along. It must be quite daunting with just one person on the panel, so congratulations. I'd like to kind of follow on from the questions that Donald Cameron has been asking. I was really interested in the Spring Project and note that Healthy Options Oban is involved in that, which is in my constituency, and I know the fantastic work they do. I think it was interesting because you talked a bit about collaboration, the fact that this, if you can give us any more information about the fact that this project is a collaboration between Scottish groups and also Northern Irish groups, and you know how that's worked. Perhaps there's something we can learn from the fact that the funding's coming from different sources. If you've got any further information on that.
Again, I'm not an expert in the finer details. I have been involved in the finer details of the work, but I think that what is key, going back to that collaboration, what is key here is that the people that came together originally had a vision for their organisations and for meeting the needs of their communities. It's been taken from a grassroots approach. It's not been a top-down approach, and I think that's probably key to its success. Mm-hmm. I would say, however, that although I've put the Spring social prescribing into that document, social prescribing isn't working terribly well elsewhere in the country, because it's not resourced. There's an attitude that social prescribing is happening and it is the answer, really, but it's not being resourced. So there aren't the links with GPs in the way that there could be. I think that, again, is down to capacity on both sides. There isn't an understanding. And I think that what's lovely about the Spring Social Prescribing Project is that it started to develop some of that understanding and is able to share that. But what I would say is it's not normal. You know, it's not happening elsewhere in the same way. It has attracted resource investment. It has attracted interest, and that's part of its success. And that's probably to do with some of the voices involved as well.
Yeah, I think
you have the right people at the table.
I think that's fair. I mean, I asked Rob McGee last week from Arts, Culture, Health and Wellbeing Scotland about the whole thing of perception around social prescribing, and the fact that there members of the public may simply expect to go to the doctor and get antibiotics, and it might come as a bit of a shock. And it's how do you get over that barrier, I suppose. So, and I think Healthy Options in Oban has actually done that incredibly well. I'm also interested again from the work, the preparation that you've done for coming to see us. You put a survey out to your members. Is there anything additional, any real learning points that we can get from what the members of Send Scot have said to you?
So the membership is an interesting one, because you get a variety of different answers in a variety of different ways. So sometimes it's about drilling down and picking up the phone to them and having those broader conversations. I think the message at the moment is that the life is hard out there for organisations. It's tough, and that they need support, and they need resource, they need financial support in some cases, but actually they need, beyond that, they need some support to create those stronger relationships. at all levels, actually. So that's relationships within their own community, within organisations that already exist. But they need support to develop in stronger relationships with national government and with local government as well. I think that, you know, at the beginning, I had made a comment around the funding, and that came out really strongly around this idea that the government has in the past promised that longer term funding, the 3-year funding deals, which then filters down to a variety of different practitioners. So that's working with creatives themselves. And there's a real concern. This was probably the strongest message that was coming out, was that's never been delivered on for various reasons. Most recent, probably COVID has somewhat got in the way. But there's a push, I guess, from the sector actually to say, can we have longer, more supportive relationships so that we can actually start to develop and to not have to constantly be, I guess, chasing their tail, trying to just survive the next year, but rather able to put in longer term plans to really develop the work that they're doing. I think that's probably something that came out incredibly strong with everybody that I spoke to.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Sarah. I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you. Could I turn to Maurice Golden, please?
Thank you, Deputy Convener, and welcome, Sarah. Just following on from your last comments, I know you're talking about multi-year funding settlements, but in addition to that, a number of cultural and creative organisations will have seen a freeze in funding level over the last few years, with effectively a reduction in real-term funding as a result of inflationary pressures and adopting fair work practices. And I just wonder what members are telling you about those inflationary pressures and how you would like to see these mitigated through funding agreements.
Yeah, so that's something I think that's really key to moving forward. You're absolutely right. Organisations are working on less and less each year, which is making things tighter and tighter and making it quite difficult to deliver on Fair Work. Now, these are organisations that we're working with that Fair Work is at the heart of the organisation, so it's something they want to deliver, that many of them have been delivering for many years. But as the purse strings are tightened, it becomes more and more difficult to make that happen. You know, it's obviously up to government to set budgets, but I think that there is an ask that inflation is taken into consideration when funding organisations, again, going back to those longer term settlements, but also to look at contracts as well and how contracts work, creating more opportunities. The thing is that organisations that are out there, they don't want handouts. They're happy to work for what for what they do, but what they want is a fair shout, I guess. They want to be able to tap into those funds and do it fairly and not constantly be having to scrabble around trying to make things work at the back. And I think there's issues around, you'll be aware that when funding comes through, there's lots of caveats attached. So it might be that core funding is not available or capital funding is not available, which means there's this constant going to different people and trying to fit lots of different things together. And I think a more flexible approach to actually, what does an organisation need to succeed? What do we need to make them and support them to become sustainable, so that we can then move on and continue to support other organisations, and that they can continue to support startups as well? Because we see that every day. We see organisations in social enterprise and the cultural and creative sectors supporting one another and supporting startups. So I think if you have a mature relationship that is about supporting them to move to the next step, as opposed to just keeping them constantly in one place struggling, I think that that is the way forward and is what people really are asking for.
Thanks, Sarah. And you've kind of touched on in your answer there, but one of the recommendations that you've highlighted is around commissioning and procurement as a potential market for cultural and creative organisations. But I can imagine that this sector is not necessarily as aligned as others in terms of providing goods and services. But you've noted that the Glasgow Connected Arts Network is an example of where this can work very well. And I just wondered what more the Scottish Government and other public bodies can do to create potential markets for cultural and creative organisations.
So this is something actually that we've been working on for a little while. Within the social enterprise world, procurement many years ago cropped up as an issue, and the Scottish Government put in a lot of support to allow the sector to start to develop opportunities. So there was a project called Ready for Business at the time, which was public sector facing in majority and was very much about educating and supporting the public sector so that they could understand how they could procure from the third sector. And at the back of that, training has obviously come in and support has come in for the third sector to be able to up skills so that they were in a position to be able to take on contracts and bid in for contracts. Followed that, the Partnership for Procurement team, they have very much been about that collaborative effect. So bringing groups together, recognising that one person running an organisation doesn't have the ability to deliver a massive contract, but can they come together to deliver that? And I think that there's lots of learning there for the cultural and creative sectors. I think that there's an opportunity to go out to the public sector and help them understand what kind of commissioning they could be involved with. Because there's sometimes a lack of imagination, perhaps, in how commissioners are working. And I think that the cultural and creative sector is there perfectly to support some of that imaginative way of working. And there's real interest in the sector. If you're sitting in a room full of creatives and you start talking about procurement, they're interested, but there is a lack of opportunities. So I think that there's work to be done in building the market. And at the back of that, there is work to be done with the sector to upskill them, to provide those opportunities for them to come together, such as the GAP project, which is about that collaborative work. I would say the GAP is not just about procurement, but also about funding as well. So it's allowing them to come together. I guess going back to that previous question about collaborative working around health, it's allowing them to go for particular projects that they can work in together, so they can bring in those different practitioners that have those different pieces of expertise to allow them to deliver projects that they believe a particular community needs. But I think that there's learning from other sectors that we could definitely take. And I think with the right resource and investment, bringing the right groups of people to the table, I think that we could certainly do that. We could certainly create a system where we're changing the way that procurement opportunities arise and opening up a market.
Thanks, Sarah. That was very interesting. A similar situation with sustainable procurement as well. Yeah. Thanks for your contribution, and over to you, Deputy Convener.
Thank you. I think on this subject, Sarah Boyack has a supplementary question. Sarah.
Thanks very much. It's really to follow on the first two sets of questions, both from Jenny Minto and from Maurice Golden, because on the one hand, it's clear that there's quite a lot of support for the principle of social prescribing. You've got some very good experience on the ground that shows that it works. And then you've got the points that were made by Maurice about the lack of multi-year funding, which means you can't actually develop the connections with the health sector to enable people to be recommended, but equally the organisations can't plan ahead and guarantee that there's going to be that fair work. And one of the bits of evidence we've had in previous sessions is that COVID has just knocked the freelancers or the creative sector for six, because it's become a hand-to-mouth existence and people have just had to move out the sector. So from where we are now, what would you recommend as a way to kickstart the fact that we don't have the networks and the funding? Is it getting money in place and a commitment to multi-year funding? What would you advise us to be asking the Scottish Government to do now to start getting the mechanisms in place?
So I think there's probably a variety of different things. Certainly the multi-year funding definitely needs addressing. That obviously only reaches a certain number of organisations. You don't fund everybody. I think there's also an issue with sitting alongside that, and I believe I mentioned it in the evidence, was asking government to pay up on time as well. So that's simple, you know, you've got something agreed for April, but it's not paid to September, is a really difficult situation to put people in. So I think that as we go forward into the new financial year, can we address that to make sure that when funding is agreed, is paid promptly to allow people to move on? Because if you're asking people to recover just now, but they've got to survive for 6 months on their reserves, you've promised them money, but they don't know that money's definitely going to come in. So there is always that fear. They can't deliver on fair work. They can't start to work. And I think this is where it's really important. They can't start to work with freelancers, bringing in those creatives that have been really struggling through COVID and haven't had those opportunities. So if you start to put that into place, making sure that we have that longer term funding, making sure that we have that commitment to pay straight away, then it has that ripple effect and starts to support the rest of the sector. But while that is going on, obviously you're working very closely with Creative Scotland and the funding streams that they have. There are pieces of work, I think, to be done around that, particularly around the language used and reaching out beyond the usual suspects, I think. I would note as well, actually, that I think that one issue that I've come across repeatedly when working with cultural and creative social enterprises is the lack of connection between third sector support and cultural and creative sector support. There is that lack of joined up thinking. So I think that there's a need, again, it's about that education, there's a need to bring those two areas together to get people understanding what is out there, so that we're not duplicating efforts. Do Creative Scotland actually need to build a business support wing? I doubt it, because actually business support exists elsewhere, but the business support that exists elsewhere currently doesn't have the expertise for creatives. That's what we hear all the time, that actually when they go for business support, there's a lack of understanding about what creatives actually do. And so I think there's an awful lot to be done around that. But I think that there are opportunities to talk directly to the sector and explore projects and ideas that they have, working through the networks that already exist. Although there doesn't seem to be one voice for the cultural sector, I think that would be pretty difficult because it's so many industries in there. There are lots of voices, really strong voices, incredibly supportive. And although people have dropped out in many cases, they're still connected to those networks. They're still connected to the grassroots. And I, you know, something that we talk about at Senscot all the time is that importance of giving people at the grassroots a voice and giving them the opportunity to explore their own solutions. So I think that probably the key areas really that we'd ask would be that longer term settlement funding with a commitment to pay quickly and efficiently. And to, I guess, to get rid of some of the bureaucracy around that as well, but also to start to explore that voice and to start to make those broader connections and support the networks that already exist out there so that they can tell you themselves exactly what their members need and can put those provisions in place. I think that the support, if it goes straight to grassroots, they have to have a voice about what that support looks like. It can't be a top-down approach.
Thanks.
Hope that answered the question.
No, it does. And the point you made about business support for the creative sector in particular, given the circumstances, is actually something that comes across quite loudly. And I think both in the questions that Jenny and Morris asked, there was that disconnect between the ambitions and then the reality. So I think that's something that's definitely worth us reflecting on. Thank you, Deputy Commissioner.
Thank you. Can I turn to Alistair Allan, please?
Thank you, Convener. Just really to ask about the business of mainstreaming the funding of arts and culture in bigger projects, infrastructure projects, whether it's town centres or whether it's, we've talked in the past in this committee about the big projects for the health service as well. I just wonder, looking at other countries, Ireland has been cited as an example where a percentage of the project itself is ring-fenced or earmarked for culture and arts. And I just wonder if you think we've anything to learn from that model.
Absolutely. That's certainly something that I hear repeatedly, that I think there's a general feeling that culture isn't respected, that actually it's left to last. It's seen quite often as the most effective. There's a panic sets in when projects are not being delivered on time. Let's bring in the creatives. They'll be able to fix it for us. But they're not valued and put right at the heart of projects. So I think that is something that is felt. I don't know if that is true across the board, but it's certainly something that I hear that is felt quite strongly in the sector. I think there is a really strong desire, and I know that Culture Counts have been doing lots of work around the national planning framework and the importance of making sure that culture is right at the heart of that. I think there's still a need to really drive home the importance of culture and the importance of culture in planning and projects. I think that ring fencing amounts to ensure that that's delivered would be fantastically useful. However, something that's also come back to me, and I may cause some division here between the creatives, but certainly I'm talking about social enterprises I work with, is there is an anger quite often about public art and the way that it's created. And actually, organisations are saying, why have they spent all that money on something that's going to sit in the middle of a roundabout when they could have spent that money on something that is a collaborative approach that we could have worked directly with the community with and work in a completely different way. So again, that's possibly slightly diverse. I think that you might get some very different opinions if you're speaking to different artists, but from the social enterprises I'm working with, that comes across as a very strong opinion. That actually they would really like to have a seat at the table. They would really like to be resourced and be allowed to have that impact. And with them, they would like to bring their local community as well. So I think that it's a twofold thing. It's not just about the creatives, but actually it gives that broader connection to the community and to the residents as well.
Thank you, Candida.
Could I turn next to Mark Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Morning, Sarah. I wanted to ask you about how we sort of map out the good work that's happening around Scotland. And I think we heard last week in evidence that Creative Scotland are doing some of the mapping, but it perhaps excludes those organisations that are working with the NHS. I don't know if you've got thoughts on how we do that. How do we get to grips with the extent of the work that's happening around Scotland? And, do we approach that from a Creative Scotland point of view or from a SenScot point of view? Or are there other organisations who should be taking the lead and making sure that we understand everything that's going on and the value of that?
I think that is a massive undertaking because of the sheer amount of work that is going on across Scotland. I certainly think that Creative Scotland have a role within that because of the relationships that they already have. However, an organisation doesn't have a relationship with Creative Scotland if it's not funded by Creative Scotland, and there's an awful lot of organisations that aren't funded. There is the social enterprise census that happens every couple of years, funded by the Scottish Government. And within that, there is information about cultural and creative organisations that are social enterprises. It's very limited information. You will have more access to the data than I would, so it's perhaps something that you might want to explore. There's potentially something that could be done to insert more questions and develop the information that is gathered. But again, that's just looking at social enterprises. It's not looking at the broader third sector, and it's not looking at independent and sole traders. So I think that there are I suspect that there are probably a few different organisations that could come to the table to have that conversation. Certainly the likes of SCVO would be useful to make those connections, Voluntary Arts Scotland, that, you know, there's a whole raft of different organisations, I think, that would be useful to bring to the table to have a conversation about what that looks like. If it's looking just at health, then obviously the NHS themselves are the organisation to go with. And we've got some fantastic examples of organisations that are delivering on contracts, or are a partner, or are picking up the scraps, so to speak, and don't have an official relationship. So, and it would be nice to be able to gather information and get a picture of what that looks like. And we also have organisations such as ArtLink Central in Stirling, who have a really strong presence at the local hospital, Forth Valley Royal Hospital, and would probably be the type of organisation that might be worth having a conversation with. They, at one point, had I've forgotten the name of that. They had a network, and it was around prisons and health, working in prisons and health, because prisons is probably a useful connection as well to be making if you're looking at data around this stuff, the work that's happening in prisons across the country. I think maybe an issue around counting some of this stuff might be what's culture, and I hate to bring that up because I'm sure that you've had that conversation many times, but I think for organisations, helping them understand their own activity is part of the process of counting. So what is culture? What is creative? And that you might have to put some parameters on exactly what that looks like. Yeah. It's a big piece of work, but we would be very interested in being linked in with a piece of work like that, I think.
Okay. So obviously there's a big and very intricate kind of national picture. There's also the very, very local picture. And I suppose that leads me to the question about who kind of leads on strategy and development. Are councils able to do this? Are they willing to do it? Is there inconsistency across Scotland? I think we heard last week about Renfrewshire, I think, that's doing some good work on social prescribing. But, you know, is it a bit of a postcode lottery as to how social enterprise and cultural enterprise organisations, however we wish to define them, are actually being supported? And is there good practice from community planning partnerships or elsewhere to really point to as to how to do this effectively?
Yeah, I would completely agree. There's a complete postcode lottery. It entirely depends, not just on the local authority, but the people involved. It depends on the individuals in a role. And as soon as somebody leaves a post, it can create huge issues and projects get dropped. And we see that, in fact, we saw that with Centre Stage in Kilmarnock and the fantastic work that they were doing. And they were working really closely with a school, member of staff changed, and they no longer work with that school because it all comes down to one individual. So I think there's work to be done around policy, probably, to make sure that that is happening, to make sure that there is... there's some sort of impetus to make it happen, to drive things forward. But yeah, there's lots of little cases of great examples and great relationships. But I don't think I could even say across one local authority, this local authority is doing it brilliantly, because again, it's just in particular areas. So I don't think anywhere has it right. And there's lots of opportunities out there. So I think there's the only way is forward and up, is the way I feel at the moment.
Yeah. So, but I mean, is there what needs to change then? Is it a duty on local authorities? Is it a commitment through community planning partnerships or something else that this has to be addressed rather than it being dependent on, as you say, you know, a good relationship between one officer and the council and bodies or whatever?
So I think that it has to fall on somebody's shoulders somewhere, and there certainly, I think, within a local authority there should be some sort of responsibility taken. The same with local health board as well. I think I would be concerned about CPPs and their capacity, but I think that they definitely have a voice, and it would be useful possibly to have that conversation with them. I'm afraid I don't know personally enough about how they operate to be able to comment on that, but I think it would be definitely worth having them at the table to have that conversation. But I think that there has to be, it has to sit somewhere with as a responsibility, so local authority and health board. But the issue is that as soon as you do that, it takes away from grassroots, it takes the voice away from grassroots. So I'm not sure how you work that dynamic to ensure that actually the grassroots voices are valued, heard, are at the table, are part of that planning process, as opposed to that top-down approach, local authority comes in and says, we're going to do this, which would happen in some areas. I'm not saying every area, but it would happen in some areas. And you really want to get to a position where it's not like that, it's grassroots-led. So perhaps working with the CDPs is a perfect opportunity. But I would agree that responsibility has to lie somewhere, and possibly it is with local authorities and health boards. But maybe it's about the wording of that and the model that's developed around that.
It seems like a difficult balance between ensuring you've got the conditions for creativity without over-formalising that to the point that you stifle that. I've just got one last question that's related to that. It's about monitoring and evaluation and around whether there's that capacity within the wider social enterprise and creative sector to really articulate what the sector does in the language that NHS and other bodies that have got harder targets can understand and go, oh yes, I can see that saving X thousand pounds or whatever, which I know is a bit dry, but you know, I suppose chief financial officers of these organisations need to see that stuff.
Yeah, so I'm glad you brought that up actually, because it's a bit of a bugbear of mine. I think that when it comes to evaluation, for many years it's been put upon social enterprises to evaluate the work that they do, to provide evidence that the work that they do is delivering what it says. And that goes beyond just delivering a project, but delivering that social and environmental value that they... So my issue is that on an organisation that already is working at full capacity, that is already struggling and over-delivering, why should they be the ones to provide that evidence? And in actual fact, is it something that government and academia and other partners could be working with to ensure that that story is told and so the reliance is not put onto social enterprises? Actually, it comes from somewhere else to work with those grassroots organisations, but it's not put upon them. Because I think that it's really unfair to ask people to respond to their community needs, which they're doing. And we saw through COVID how quickly, and we see today with the war in Ukraine and how many communities are leaping, you know, to drive things forward. To ask them to start to evaluate everything they do as well is a big ask. When you don't have, you've all quite often got one person running an organisation held up by a few volunteers, and those volunteers might have issues of their own and require support as well. So it's a big ask. So I think my ask from government around that, creating that evidence approach, would be support to do that. Don't place it on the shoulders of the social enterprises, of the cultural and creative organisations themselves, but rather work with them, bring the resource and support to make sure that evidence is collated. That makes sense.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense, yeah. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. I have a question from Sarah Boyack.
Thanks. It's been really good hearing where we potentially could get different funding streams. One of the things that you've mentioned in your evidence is the principle of local infrastructure projects. And I think you mentioned it earlier today. Could you say a little bit more about that, the concept of the percent for art scheme, so that you see local investment and how you would try and make sure that that did actually reach local communities, having an influence on what money should be spent on, rather than as you described it, something in the middle of a roundabout?
Yes. So actually, this is something that has come from the Culture Counts members. So we are part of Culture Counts. I'm sure that you will all be aware of the work that they do. So this is something that's come from that relationship, as opposed to the relationships with the social enterprises, if that makes sense, although some social enterprises are linked into that too. But I just wanted to clarify where that conversation comes from. I think that again, it might be worth having a conversation with Culture Council around this and asking them for some more information on their thoughts around this, because I know that they have done some work and I'm sure that they would be happy to share what they have. I think that there was some of this conversation came originally from the conversations around participatory budgeting, which is hard to say, and how that was being what was happening in particular areas and the impact that that was happening as well. And then there's obviously the conversations that are happening around the national planning framework as well, and the opportunities around that. So I think that the conversation really that's coming out is going back to exactly what I pointed out earlier about the value of culture and the value of local arts. So it's about, I guess, telling that story, maybe going back to that language again that we're talking about with Mark, is trying to tell that story, help people understand the value of culture. And I guess that goes beyond just procurers and local authority, it actually goes to general public as well, helping them understand the value of their own culture. And so that when we are in a position of planning, when we're in major infrastructure projects, that it's understood that part of that money should go towards cultural and arts, as opposed to always lying with something that is, I guess, that I think that my issue is that there's the lack of imagination again. I think it's about working with creatives. They can come up with some really interesting pieces of work, again, dealing with issues at a very local level and working with that local community to ensure that you've got that cohesive relationship going on. So they bring in an awful lot to the table. So I think it comes back to that value, making sure that that everybody understands how important culture is, so that when we talk about local infrastructure projects and ring fencing funding for arts and culture, we're talking beyond public art projects. Actually, we're talking beyond that, and we're talking about something that's greater and involves more people, and brings in that the relationships and building of community as well, because I think that's probably something that's quite important, the building of community as we go forward and supporting communities to come together as communities. I'm not sure I've quite answered that right.
No, but you've given us some points to go on in the future. So thank you very much for that, Sarah. Back to you, Deputy Convener.
Thank you. I think if no one else has questions, if I could finish, Sarah, with one final question. The Scottish Government's resource spending review document, which is the subject of this particular inquiry by the committee, states that it's heavily influenced by the Christie principles on the future of public services, which I'm sure you're aware of. The Christie Commission was published in 2011, and it has several points to it. We've talked about mainstreaming already, but it also places an emphasis on preventing negative outcomes from arising. And I just wondered, in your view, what progress has been made in delivering a preventative approach since Christie was published back in 2011?
Gosh, that's quite a big question. I think probably limited, very limited. There are excellent pieces of work that have gone on that are continuing to go on. I wonder if some of that work has been lost in recent years, though. I wonder if actually there is the promises sitting there, but actually other things have taken hold and taken, you know, more importance, and some of that work has been put on hold. I think that when you're talking to social enterprises themselves on the ground, not engaged with government, not engaged with local authority, not engaged with health boards, but just doing the work, I would say that their actions are all about preventative actions. It all sits around that. it all is about supporting people. But I'm not sure that, I think that I would probably have to go away and ask more people about that question, actually, because I think it's quite a big question. But I'm not sure that it, the importance is put on it in the same way, perhaps, when funding is coming through, when opportunities are coming through. I think maybe it's been lost a little bit. But to be honest, I think before I was willing to completely put 100% behind that, I would like to go, I guess, out to members and ask them just exactly that question.
Well, I think, you know, the committee would be really interested in that, and we would be more than happy to allow you to do that, because, you know, we talk about preventative health a lot, but I think in the wider sort of cultural context, I think that would be really, really kind of you if you could canvas opinion in that regard and report back to us if that's okay.
Yeah, absolutely. I can do that. I will be sure to speak to members and engage an opinion and can submit something to you.
Excellent. Thank you very much. So can I thank you for attending the meeting on your own and for your time this morning. It's been a really useful session. And with that, can I now suspend the meeting and we move into private session. Thank you.
Thank you.